Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. The Lord be with you. Welcome everyone as we gather for our worship for the 25th Sunday after Pentecost. And we welcome visitors among us this morning and those who are joining us online. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. after it shall cease to be, you are God. Break into our short span of life and show us those things that are eternal, that we may serve your purpose in all we do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in unity with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the scripture reading.
A reading from the book of Judges. The Israelites again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord after Ahab had died. So the Lord sold them into the hand of King Jabin of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. The commander of his army was Sisera, who lived in Harosheth-hagoyim. Then the Israelites cried out to the Lord for help, for he had 900 chariots of iron and had oppressed the Israelites cruelly for 20 years. At that time, Deborah, a prophetess, wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel. She used to sit under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim. And the Israelites came up to her for judgment. She sent and summoned Barak, son of Abinoam, from Kedesh and Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord God of Israel commands you, go, take position on my table, bringing 10,000 from the tribe of Naphtali and the tribe of Zebulun. I will draw out Sisera, the general of Jabin's army, to meet you by the Wadi Kishon and his chariots and his troops, and I will give him into your hand." For the word of the Lord.
Reading from the first letter of Paul to the Thessalonians. Concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for making yourself known to us through your word. We ask you to encourage us in our faith so that we may be ready to serve for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. This year, in our 3-year cycle of readings, we have been travelling once again through the Gospel of Matthew. And as we have, I've suggested that many of Jesus' parables are not quite as easy to interpret as they might seem to be at first glance. Matthew wrote that even Jesus' disciples had difficulty understanding his parables. So if the disciples had trouble, what chance do we have? The parable before us in today's Gospel is yet another example of how interpreting parables can be complicated, even if at first glance the parable seems straightforward. The parable of the talents has usually been trotted out during stewardship campaigns and has traditionally been interpreted as being about our stewardship of all that God has given us. In this interpretation, God has given us time, talents, and money, which we need to use for God's kingdom. And if we do this, God will amply reward us. But if we bury our talents, refusing to invest them, God will judge us to be worthless servants, and we will be quite justifiably punished. While we often use talents to refer to one's skills and gifts, the word in this context refers to a very considerable amount of money, usually consisting of gold or silver. One talent was worth roughly 20 years of an ordinary labourer's wages. A talent thus represented a huge amount of money. It would be the modern equivalent about $1.5 million. In the parable, each slave was given an amount according to his own ability. We are told that the first two slaves worked with the talents they were given. The third, however, buried the talent, which would have weighed about 50 kilograms, in the ground. When the master returned to settle the accounts, the first two slaves are praised and rewarded, while the third is chastised and called wicked and lazy. The first two slaves enter into the joy of their master. The third slave's talent is taken from him and given to the first slave, and he is cast into the outer darkness. Yet in the culture of that time and place, the third slave of the parable does nothing wrong. Burying money was considered a suitable security measure, according to Jewish writings at the time. A few months ago, we heard the parable of the hidden treasure, where somebody goes into a field and digs up a treasure that he finds. The words that are used to describe the third slave suggest that the master believed that he lacked ambition. The master is basically calling him a bludger, as we would say in Australia. The final character in this parable is the master, or landowner. In a traditional interpretation of this parable, the master is God. If we do accept that the master in the parable is God, then what are we saying about God? Are we saying that God is a disciplinarian, quick to punish those who don't measure up? And we may believe that everything bad in our lives is a punishment from God, the divine headmaster in the sky. Or do we see God in a different way? More in the way that St. Paul talks about God in our second reading from the first letter to the Thessalonians, where Paul tells the Thessalonians, God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us. I would like to suggest that if we look at this parable in this way, and in the context in which it was said and written, we may get a completely different picture of what Jesus is actually saying, and who is who in this parable. In first century Judea, many peasant farmers were having their land stolen by wealthy landowners, who, under the pretext of helping small struggling farmers, would loan them money at exorbitant interest rates. When the poor farmers could not repay their debts because of drought or a bad crop, the wealthy would foreclose on the loan and take the poor farmer's land. Many modern scholars suggest that this is what the three slaves in the parable have been asked to do. They have been sent out by their master to offer loans to poor farmers, and then when they can't repay, take their land and sell it at a considerable profit when the farmers couldn't repay. This is why they leave with 5 and 2 talents and come back with 10 and 4 talents. They have basically sold the land of the poor. And so the more they get off these poor farmers, the greater their reward and the greater the money earned by their master, which is why the master is pleased with the first 2 slaves, because they have made massive profits for him. If this is the correct way to look at this parable, it is very feasible to actually see the 3rd slave as the hero of this story. It has been suggested that those who would have heard this parable originally would have been far more likely to have identified with the 3rd slave rather than the 2. The parable in this view is thus not about what Christians do with their gifts and talents, as valuable as that may be, but is a parable about speaking truth to power and choosing not to uphold powerful and unjust systems. The 3rd slave in the story is the hero because he refuses to take part in the oppression and exploitation of poor landholders. Some scholars have suggested that the 3rd slave in the parable is Jesus. Just days after telling this parable, Jesus was himself cast into the outer darkness, crucifixion, agony, and death. And like the 3rd slave, he was considered worthless and disposable by the powerful and wealthy. But I would also like to suggest that the 3rd slave is the church of Matthew's day. The church Matthew wrote his gospel for was experiencing persecution for being different, for not fitting in with the way of the world filled with corruption and the abuse of power. The early Christians were choosing a different way to lead their lives together, one which meant that they were the outcasts. As people who saw the world differently, the early Christians could choose the way of the world with its wealth and short-term rewards, or they could choose the way of faith, integrity, and justice. A way which may well have meant that even the little they had would be taken away from them. They could follow the masters of wealth and power, or they could follow their new master, the one who exemplified the grace and goodness of God, and who would offer eternal rewards for all who follow his way of justice and peace. This difficult choice faces all those in every generation who would seek to find their reward, either in the glories of this world or in the glory of God. The Lord be with you. Page 7 of our Orders of Service, let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit in the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the world and for the Church.
God, our Creator, you entrusted our gift with gifts to use in your service and the service of your people. Hear our prayers for the world and for the Church. We give you thanks for those who have gifted with wisdom, who, with a passion for peace in our nation and our world. We pray for the world, for those countries and people who face uncertainty because of unstable or corrupt governments. We pray for those nations and people struggling through waves of violence and war. Praying for the people of Palestine and Israel, Ukraine and Russia, Ethiopia, Haiti, Myanmar and Sudan. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give you thanks for those who have been given gifts of leadership in your Church, for the bishops, clergy, and lay leaders who equip your Church for its mission in the world. We pray for the Anglican Church in Australia, praying today for Archbishop Kate Goldsworthy, Regional Bishop Kate Wilmot, and Assistant Bishop-elect, and Venerable David Bassett, and Reverend Hans Christiansen, and for the clergy and people of the Diocese of Perth. We pray for the Very Reverend Chris Chataway and for the clergy and people of St George's Cathedral in Perth. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We give you thanks for those within our community who lead our community. We pray for our Mayor, Dean Rees, for all councillors, and all who work for the Council of the Rural City of Wangaratta. We give thanks for those who nurture the young and care for the old, and for all who bring your love to others. We pray for those within our community who are marginalised, and all whose contributions are not valued, for those who feel frightened and alone. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We give you thanks for those with gifts of healing, who bring health to the bodies, minds, and spirits of others. We pray for all who are in need, for those who are sick and dying, for those who mourn their loved ones, and for all who care for them. We pray for all of those on our parish list of prayer, for those who we know personally, and for those whose pain is known only to you. Lord, in your mercy. We remember your faithful servants in every age, for all who have followed your faithfulness and set their lives to your service. We remember those who have died recently, remembering especially Maureen Matthews, and for those whose year's mind falls this week. Help us to follow their example, that our life's end we may too be found to be good and faithful servants, and enter into the joy of your eternal presence. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. God of peace, we bring before you our own prayers at this time. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive it. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, and with grateful thanks we offer these gifts, and this bread and wine, fruits of your earth and of our labour, signs of your redemptive purpose for our lives and for all creation. Blessed be God for ever. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. My arms stretch out, lifting me high. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in all creation. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have any need. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. My arms stretch out, lifting me high. The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We give them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty, our joy, and our salvation, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For he is the true High Priest, who has freed us from our sins, and made us a royal priesthood to serve you, our God and Father. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing.
Commemorate and celebrate his saving passion and death.
his mighty resurrection and ascension into heaven, and we eagerly await his coming again in glory. We thank you that by your grace alone you have accepted us in Christ. And here we offer you a spiritual sacrifice, holy and acceptable in your sight. Through Christ, receive this our duty and service, and grant that we who eat and drink these holy gifts may by your Holy Spirit be one body in Christ, and serve you in unity and peace. In your grace and mercy, bring us to the joy of your eternal kingdom, with all the company of the redeemed. May we praise you in union with them, and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father eternal, in songs of never-ending praise. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share in one bread. Thank you. Living God, in this holy meal, you fill us with new hope. May the power of your love, which we have known in word and sacrament, continue your saving work among us. Give us courage for our pilgrimage and bring us to the joys you promise. Father, we offer ourselves to you as living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and to work to your praise and glory. Once again, welcome to visitors we have with us this morning. We hope you can join us for morning tea, which will be in Purbeck Hall out to the right, as you leave the cathedral. Directly after the service this morning, we're going to plant our season of creation tree in the what consists of an orchard out the back of Purbeck Hall, along with the other citrus trees out the back there. I was going to do it next week as part of the annual parish meeting, but I'm not sure the tree will last that long, so I thought we'd better put it in the ground now. So that'll take place directly after we've concluded worship. It was with great sadness that we heard last week of the sudden death of Maureen Matthews, who was a regular member of the 8 a.m. congregation, but who also occasionally came to the 10 a.m. service as well. Maureen was part of the congregation here for well over 30 years. Maureen's funeral will be at here at the cathedral on Tuesday at 11:30. Then we've got the Friends Committee at 2 p.m. in the afternoon there, and then Bishop Clarence will be celebrating and preaching the Wednesday morning Eucharist on Wednesday at 10 a.m. Please keep in mind the grammar grocery and also the notice about the requirements for Loaves and Fishes Christians Caring. We've had a bit of a drop off in the number of items being donated here at the cathedral, so if you can keep that in mind, even if you brought an item or two at the beginning of the month or at various stages during the month, that would be a great help. Christmas cards are available. Parish Christmas cards are now available from the cathedral shop. They're $15 for 10. You can have a look at them in the cathedral shop or ask Stephanie. As I said, the annual parish meeting will be next Sunday at 11:30 a.m. There's no elections this year, so I'm hoping that without controversy we'll be able to start lunch at 12 o'clock. And seeing as there's no elections this year, we go on the three-year cycle. Last year was the first one, so we've got another couple of years before elections will be held. You can still order Christmas puddings through Elizabeth, so thank you to the Savory family. And with your commitment cards and time and talent sheets, you've got until next week to bring them in, so please do so and just place them in the offertory plate, offertory bowl, when you come in on a Sunday morning. And please keep Kathy and Leslie in your prayers as they prepare to be ordained on Saturday, 2nd of December, here at the cathedral. And if you are coming, there is a list at the back. Please place your name on it so that we have an idea of numbers. Thank you. Now, one of our choir, Eva, is going to tell us about a trip she made. Where did you go?
Samoa.
We have a partnership with the school in Samoa, and so Eva was part of the last trip to All Saints, is it? All Saints School in Samoa. So Eva's just going to tell us a bit about her trip, and then Kieran's going to talk to you about the Bring and Share lunch next week. Thank you, Eva.
Good morning, everyone. We
opportunity. When we were going to the airport, I didn't read the flight, so we were 2 hours early. We were all annoyed, but mainly mum and dad, but we figured that out. It was so good to meet all these year 10s. We made so many friends, and we actually jumped off a waterfall, too, in fact. And it was, there was so much water. We went swimming for the first week, and it was just amazing. The plane was a 6-hour flight, which was pretty boring, but we got there. When we went to to All Saints School, Little Saints, it made me realize how lucky we are here. So these little boys and girls, they had one or two pencils and would share a sharpener around, and they would be happy with that. So it just makes me really grateful for what we have here. When we were at the Livingston, which is where we stayed for the 2 weeks, we all cooked meals, so we all got to learn how to cook and make food for everyone. And it was amazing. And I'm so grateful for what our teachers did. And one thing that I loved about the trip was Tossie. He would play guitar at night, and everyone would sit out after dinner. And it was just amazing. I loved it so much. It was really humid, but we got used to it, and I'd just like to say thank you for the opportunity and to my teachers. Thank you.
Thank you, Eva. It's always good to remember that all of us have lives beyond the time when we're here. And these sorts of experiences of travel are very formative. And so thank you, Eva, for sharing your reflections. I have a little red folder, and I'm going to give it to Elizabeth, who's about to stand up and wave at you. So these are two things you need to know. Red folder and Elizabeth. Elizabeth will be hanging out at the back of the church at the end of the service. In the folder there is a sign-up sheet for the Bring and Share lunch next Sunday. And it runs pretty much the way it did for the Bring and Share lunch that we had back in June. Put your name down, tell us what you want to bring. And then once you've made that decision and that commitment, take a pink sheet, because you need to put your ingredients on the back of it. Lunch next week, I hope will be a time for us all to spend some time together, obviously, but also to celebrate almost our first really just plain normal year post-COVID. It's been a very disruptive time over the last 3 years, and it's good to be able to do these things. So, just to check, did you hear me? What's the first thing you need to remember? Speak to
Elizabeth.
Thank you.
If you haven't understood, ask Marguerite. She's obviously an adult. Would you please stand for our sending hymn? peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. In the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ.